Hi, everyone, and welcome to a very special recording for Introvert Awareness Month, brought to you by iConnect, which is Amazon's affinity group and hub of support for introverted leaders and for the managers and coworkers who work with them and get to benefit from having them on their teams. We're very excited for this ongoing part in our series of focusing on the introvert's power. While previous recordings have included an understanding of introversion and unlocking its potential, including special speakers like Glenn, who we're excited to have back, and other recordings have also focused on some of the secret superpowers and skills that come from being an introvert in the workplace, including a recent broadcast recording with Dr. Imani Dursavla. We are really excited to be bringing an especially timely conversation to you via broadcast today. While we've covered topics of importance of introversion at work and conversations with our introverted leaders here at Amazon, I think today's conversation is something that every single Amazonian is going to resonate with in special ways. Our conversation comes at a moment when people across the world are working from home, and where so many Amazonians are actively thinking about both their own superpowers and what they bring to their teams, and what their teammates and colleagues may bring to their team via our Forte process. So as we're thinking and planning for the coming year, something that I think is so important to the conversations that we're all preparing to have as our workplaces prepare for 2021, for potentially a return to offices based on your location, is how we can create introvert-friendly workplaces and create an environment that allows both our introverted and our extroverted leaders to thrive, to deliver, and ultimately to delight our customers. I am so excited to welcome you. My name is Lydia. I am an iConnect board member, and I'm also a client lead recruiter for Amazon Logistics. My background is in recruiting and HR, and I spent most of my life really trying to fake it till I make it as an extrovert, because that's what I had thought was essential to leadership and essential to adding value to the things that I cared about. Only more recently, and honestly through a lot of conversations and learnings with our iConnect leaders here at Amazon, I've been able to understand better just how valuable my introversion side is. And I've been really thankful for the opportunity to continue learning, and today for the opportunity to be part of a conversation with our really fantastic guests who are going to be sharing from their work and their research here today. So I'm going to briefly introduce our panel, and then we'll dive straight into talking about introversion, defining it, and then a conversation about how we can support introverted leaders through building increasingly inclusive, introvert-friendly workplaces. So our first guest is Dr. Jennifer Kahnweiler. She's a best-selling author and one of the top global speakers on introverts. Her books include The Introverted Leader, Quiet Influence, The Genius of Opposites, and a new one called Creating Introvert-Friendly Workplaces. Her books have been translated into 18 languages, and The Introverted Leader was named one of the top 5 business books by the Shanghai Daily. Jennifer has been a learning and development professional and leadership speaker at leading organizations like Merck, Kimberly-Clark, NASA, and Bosch, among several others, and the U.S. Centers of Disease Control. She has over 12 years of experience delivering online presentations and courses. And as you'll hear from Jennifer in her own words shortly, she's really an ally and an advocate for introverted leaders in the corporate world. I'm also excited to have Glenn Cathy joining us again for another iConnect talk. Glenn is a globally recognized sourcing and recruiting leader, a blogger, corporate and keynote speaker, and brings over 20 years of experience in the talent acquisition field. He's currently the leader of digital brand strategy at Randstad, the world's largest staffing company. He describes himself as a deeply introverted INTJ and has recently been focusing his time on shining a light on the importance of including introversion and extroversion within diversity, inclusion, and belonging. You can find his introversion manifesto on LinkedIn, along with his truly excellent Talent Connect talk and other just great resources that he's helped bring into focus for introverted leaders and the folks who support them. And then finally, I'm thrilled to be here with Theonette Hauser, who is our global founder and chair for iConnect. Theonette brings a quiet, driven force to the expansion of iConnect, to the growth and leadership and mentorship opportunities that iConnect offers, and to the really phenomenal speaker series that we are so excited to bring to you this day as part of our Introvert Awareness Month programming here at Amazon. So with this great panel, I'm thrilled to just dive right in. And my first question is a little more general. I'm going to start with Theonette, and I'm going to ask, how do you define introversion? Theo, please feel free to share the definition that resonates with you, and then I'll ask our other panelists to add to it and share what resonates with them in their work as well.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Lydia, for the question. I will go with the definition of Dr. Marty Olsen-Laney in the book, The Introvert Advantage. And here, introversion and extroversion are on opposite ends of an energy continuum, and where one falls on that continuum predicts how you derive your life energy. Those on the more introverted end of the spectrum focus inward to gain their energy, and those on the more extroverted end of the spectrum focus outwards to gain their energy. This definition also aligns with the original Jungian theory of psychoanalyst Carl Jung, as opposed to the modern day theories, focusing primarily on behaviorist means to describe introversion.
Great.
As an Amazonian, I love a thorough definition. And I really appreciate that. Jennifer and Glenn, you've both done a lot of research in this area. I'd love to hear what else you would add to that description and how you see it showing up in the work that you do.
Yeah, I appreciate Theo. Hi, everybody. And hey, Lydia and Theo and Glenn, it's really a privilege to be on the panel with you today. And hello out there in Amazon world. I think that Theo did a great job of setting the stage about what introversion is. And we've been sort of morphing into some other understandings as people are grabbing this both on the research side and also living it in a practical way. And so I just want to add just a couple of quick additions or enhancements to that theory. And I think the spectrum is absolutely what people resonate with. I'm not, you know, discreetly an introvert all the time or discreetly an extrovert. But I like to think of that spectrum with also the addition of a bell curve. So that most of us are sort of more the middle, towards the middle of the, if you think about the middle line in the bell curve there, most of us cluster towards there. And I always laugh, it's kind of like you also have people who are maybe flaming extroverts, you know, who there's always a few of those, right? We have friends like that who, you know, always out there doing, right, Lydia? But then you also have on the other side, very, very, very strong introverts in terms of preferring that as the way to be. And I have one friend who's written on this, a colleague, Maura Ahrens-Melly, who actually calls herself a hermit. She says, I'm a hermit introvert, and she's very out there in her life, but that's really what she prefers. So I would say that's the addition. In addition to, I like kind of the metaphor of a battery. It's like extroverts kind of like really get charged up with stimulation. Now, a lot of people are now talking about stimulation as being another variable in this whole definition. How much can you take? You'll meet a lot of introverts who their teams will say to them, you know, you're not an introvert. There's no way. But then they'll say, no, what I really need, and I'll ask Theo and Glenn if this is true for you guys, you know, I really, and you too, Lydia, is going back and decompressing so that I can think, I can reflect, I can rest, and then go out into the world again and being recharged. Whereas extroverts will say, yeah, I kind of like to decompress. I like to go to yoga and it's really kind of cool, but they don't have to have it. It's like a nice to have versus a must have. So those would be some of the just more, I guess, maybe everyday kind of actionable definitions that I would add to what, to build on what Theo said.
Okay, I can throw in a few other things. I really can't improve upon the definition that Theonette already shared. I'll kind of take the same vein that Jennifer just did in terms of, well, how does this really manifest itself? So you hear the definition, but an introvert, which again, I feel like I'm pretty far down on that continuum. People would say I'm quiet and reserved, right? Many introverts would say, in terms of this energy and the battery and where you get your stimulation, I would much rather hang out with two close friends than go to a party where there's a ton of people that I don't know. That's the same at conferences as well. That could be an element of the stimulation, but there's also the whole small talk. I'd rather skip small talk and go and have a deep conversation that, you know, really requires me to think a lot and reflect, as opposed to having a lot of shallow conversations with people that the conversations really feel like they're, it sounds horrible, they almost are kind of like meaningless and throwaway. But to extroverts, I've always been fascinated my entire life how that's energizing and exciting and fun. Yeah. Whereas I look at that as the complete opposite. So I think that's how some of these definitions like manifest in terms of how introverts deal with the world.
So much of that resonates with me, Glenn. I'm like, oh, I would kill for a couple close friends and a coffee more than a crowded conference any day. But I appreciate having had the opportunity to adapt and learn how to find my strength in both of those environments. Glenn, I'm going to stay with you as we pivot to our next question. You've especially on LinkedIn and in your speaking work, really helped us understand better the concept of introversion. And for those of us watching on broadcast here at Amazon, I highly recommend you search for Glenn's other topics that he shared with us here previously. Glenn, I'd love to hear more about kind of your personal journey with, maybe finding your inner introvert and then also the work that you've been doing. And I'm curious, how did you first start exploring this topic and your journey here with introversion?
Yeah, so appreciate the question. You might have to give me some kind of signal if you want me to stop, but I will try to keep it concise. It's funny, growing up, I would not, and I don't think other people would have described me as an introvert, but looking back and reflecting, I think it was really more of a function of the fact that I did have a decent sized group of friends that I hung out with most of the time. I was not really aware of introversion, extroversion, except academically. I mean, I do have a degree in psychology, but again, didn't even think about it. Until I really got into the working world, but even then it didn't occur to me, honestly, until about 2016, when I was at a LinkedIn Talent Connect event and Pat Waters was on stage talking about belonging. And you start, up until that time, it was mostly diversity and inclusion, and belonging was still somewhat of a new concept back then. And it made me kind of perk up because I understood diversity and inclusion. And if you look at me, people would not consider me to be a diverse individual. I'm certainly not underrepresented, but when she started talking about belonging, I'm like, you know what? I actually know what it feels like to not belong. So then it really resonated and made me think about, well, why is it that I feel like I don't belong a lot of the times, in work situations? And that's what made me start to look into introversion. And I was able to look back at 20 years of experience and replay many moments that I still remember now vividly, where I was either called out in the work environment for being too quiet, or that people didn't think I would be successful in my role because I was too quiet, or being a part of conversations where people are actually saying, well, what did you think of this person during an interview? I said, oh, I think this person would be a great hire. Person says, oh, I don't think they're the right fit. They're too quiet. I don't want to keep just using the word quiet, but quiet in many times is really just the label that's applied to people that are, introverts that may not speak up enough during interviews or during meetings, our team outings, those types of things. And I've definitely felt the pain of that, of feeling like I don't belong throughout my career. And that's what kind of inspired me to say, well, I can't be alone. And now I feel like I actually have something to say in the diversity, inclusion, belonging space where I can tell my story that might help other individuals. And that's really what led me to doing a ton of research over a couple of years and then writing that article you mentioned and then being invited, thankfully, by LinkedIn to actually talk about it. And then that was recorded. So I feel like it's nice to have that out there in the world where people can stumble into it, read it, watch those things, and hopefully gain some benefit as an individual introvert, what it means to be one in the working world and the world in general, but also what are some practical things companies can do to help make companies create environments that are more inclusive of introverts, where they feel like they can bring their best selves, where they feel like they can belong.
I love that. And I think that really resonates with some of the work that Jennifer, you do. I'd love to ask the same question of you. Kind of, what is your personal journey with introversion and where has that led you in your work?
Yeah, well, thank you, Lydia. I want to just respond briefly to what Glenn said, because it warms my heart. Some of I've been writing in this this space for 12 years. And one of the things that I realized in the latest research I did, and we found in companies that actually embrace introversion as a part of the circle, which are there aren't that many, you know, and you should be proud with your iConnect here as being a best practice, is that they spotlight introverted leaders like Glenn, and people are drawn to hear from him because until recently, and Pat is another person we interview Glenn for the book because she is such a leader as well, Pat Waters, who is so willing to talk about her journey. And what concerns me too, it makes me a little bit sad, is that that so many introverts had to go through feeling like they didn't fit in. Like Glenn said, you know, I didn't speak up enough. What's enough? You know, it's like the extrovert ideal seems to drive everything. On the good news, you know, I have a little granddaughter now. One of my granddaughters, I've already, her parents may not agree, but I said, I think she's introverted. And one of the things that they've given her permission to do is when she's had enough with playing with other kids, she says to you, like, I'm going to have my alone time now. Now think about how many kids would benefit from that just as they go through life with just knowing it's okay. It's, you know, one thing we didn't say in the definition, it's about wiring. There's nothing wrong with you being introverted, but it makes me sad that Glenn had, you know, that you and so many millions of others have had to go through that. And I'll just segue to my own story on it. And, you know, I'm glad you mentioned the personal angle because I wasn't aware I was an extrovert until I took the Myers-Briggs way long time ago. And it was really, I laughingly say, my husband might agree with this, is that it really did save my marriage early on because I was not knowing what was going on. I came from a very extroverted New York, you know, very vocal family where everybody talked over each other. That was just the norm. And then I met my husband who was extremely introverted from a quiet, culturally Midwest town. Nobody ever interrupted each other. Anyway, I used to say to him in the beginning of our relationship, what's wrong? What's wrong? Which I later learned you really never should say to an introvert, nothing's wrong, right? And so I was fortunate at that time to have that opportunity in my field in counseling, leadership development, coaching to become more aware of the Myers-Briggs. And fast forward, starting working in organizations, not only did it help me in my own marriage with having that lens to look through and to realize that I was an extrovert, you know, and we can talk about the differences and where there are clashes when people don't realize these two dimensions, it can really create issues on teams and in personal relationships. And I kept being drawn to the introverts. I worked a lot in technology and I was always really, really connecting with them because they felt frustrated, overlooked, ignored consistently. And it was simply because they were introverted and in the world that Glenn was describing, where they were passed over for promotions, you know, not the kind of person I want to have a beer with, you know, all of the bias that was that now we're more aware of and increasingly aware of as we go forward. So I became very committed. I didn't know that I became a champion until I started speaking more internationally, and I kind of chose the lane I wanted to be in. And there was no doubt that I wanted to explore this topic more. And so that's why I keep writing books about it and speaking, because there's more to learn and more to share.
I love that. I also really admire that your grandchild has learned to give herself some time and space. That's a skill I learned in my 30s. So let me tell you, I wish I'd known it younger. Jen, for you talk about kind of your international work, and I think that's a perfect segue to my asking Theonette the same question. Theonette, in our conversations, you've shared with me a little bit about your experience working cross-culturally and even on multiple continents. And that's something I think that resonates with a lot of Amazonians. I'd love to hear a little bit more about how introversion has shaped you and your story, but I'd also love to hear about opportunities you see for intersectionality between introvert inclusion and other identities and affinities here at Amazon.
Lydia, thank you so much for the question. And I love what Jennifer and Glenn just shared. In my case, I grew up in a very extroverted environment. The culture was just geared towards a certain type of leader. And so for me, I very early on kind of caught on to it that I needed to be a little bit more than myself. I needed to be an extrovert, even extremely, to kind of be able to fit in. But the funny thing is, now that I'm looking back, I did all of that and I still did not fit in. And I had experiences where I was in a classroom, and this is already late in my teens, where a teacher would, for example, shout at me, "Why can't you just be normal?" Or I had conversations mm-hmm. where family members or even friends would ask me, "Why can't you just show up and have a normal conversation? Why can't you talk about your job and about everyday life like a normal person? Why do you have to ask about the meaning of life, how I'm feeling? You are killing the mood." So these were my experiences. And so when I started out at Amazon, I was actually pretty lucky, because I started out with someone who, I'm not sure if he caught on that I was an introvert, or he just maybe noticed that I was a little bit shy. And he always went out of the way to include me on the team. He would invite me over at lunchtime to sit with them. He would speak up for me at times. And these are little things that colleagues can do to kind of make the experience of introverts a little bit more easier in the workplace. And I also, what Glenn shared about belonging resonates with me deeply, because I know that as a Black woman who is introverted, you can be, I mean, if you are working at Amazon, it's a diverse company, it's very, it's a diverse culture, but by virtue of being hired, you are already included. But if there's no belonging, even if you are part of a diverse company and you are included, you could still feel like you don't belong. And as we also know, if people don't feel like they belong, they don't share their success stories and ideas, they don't bring their best selves to work, and we could be missing out on so much. And now, having moved over to Germany, the culture here is a little bit more introverted. People give you a little bit more space, and so by doing all of this, I was able to kind of process everything that had happened. I was able to sit with myself and make sense of the experiences that I have had. And I'm getting to a point now with iConnect and through all of this research, speaking to these leaders on introversion, I'm starting to understand myself better, but I'm also seeing it as an opportunity to bring people together. Because if you look at all of the dimensions of diversity that we currently have, they sort of put people in boxes, whereas if you look at personality, because it's the kind of diversity that cuts across all of the other diversity traits, it brings everyone together. In our community of over 800 people now at iConnect, and they come together, they share their experiences, they give each other tips on how to present or how to contribute in a team. And I remember when we had one of our newest members from NA joining the iConnect board, he mentioned to me, "Theonette, I'm so happy that there is a place for someone like me, a white male, somewhere at Amazon where I can be part and belong," because he's an introvert and a highly sensitive person. And it's these moments where I see and I realize that I'm not alone. And also the belief that I had growing up about I'm wrong, or I will never belong, or I'm not enough, that is simply not true. I bring on the table, and I know many introverts do, we are good listeners. We bring critical thinking on the table. We are analytical people. So there's so much that introverts bring, and having introverts and extroverts come together, we can only make sure to bring the best out of our teams and our companies, and make sure that we also deliver to our customers the best, because we have a diverse team that shares.
You know, I love when you share about your experience, and I'm so grateful for just the opportunity that you saw to encourage Amazonians to bring their full selves to their work. I think this segues really beautifully into our next question, which I'm going to ask to all three of our panelists. Here at Amazon, our diversity is really key to creating the products that surprise and delight our customers. And I think we are increasingly aware of the fact that introverts bring so much to their teams, but we are actively trying to better understand how can companies benefit from their introverted leaders' strengths. So Jennifer, I'll start with you, and I'd love to hear some of the things you've seen in the practices, sure. And then we'll invite everyone to kind of dovetail in and share what they've seen as well.
One of the strengths, I want to connect to, thank you, Lydia, to what Theo has shared and Glenn. Theo, I hope this is okay. When you and I were planning this call, I think the first time we spoke, I said, how are you doing? She said, I'm very nervous about talking to you. And I kind of tell you how impressed I was. Not that she was nervous. This is not an ego thing at all, but that she actually was so honest. And I think that's what Theo and Glenn are talking about, being vulnerable and sharing and not being afraid to say that you're introverted, you know? And then we were certainly all, you know, good friends by the end of the call, I think. But I think that just being honest and self-disclosure is an important part that I want to segue to leaders. Because unless leaders really do the self-awareness work, you know, they can go to all these classes and learn about introversion. But if we don't really look at ourselves, and I'm also talking to extroverts indirectly, because I think introverts, you know, most of them really get this. And are appreciative of the fact that we're really highlighting now the strengths of introverts. But I think it's really, really important that, you know, we take a look at ourselves and really examine our own history as we've been sharing and our own like unconscious bias that we didn't necessarily know we had, and then start making efforts to really understand about what introversion is and isn't, and start to actually put in place some practical strategies. So I want to give you one example. I was teaching a class several years ago when I first got into this of all like 30 engineers in this hotel. And I remember the hotel because I came back a few years later. The first experience was very frustrating. I couldn't get people to talk. And I did what a lot of extroverts do is we talk more when people are not responding. You guys are laughing, you know, right? And so we kind of like danced faster. And the more I did that and revved it up, the less of engagement I got in the class. And it was a very tiring experience. So I had another opportunity to teach a similar class, again, 30 engineers, because I decided I had to change what I was doing. And I was teaching people who weren't like me, and they weren't going to enjoy getting into breakout groups all the time. So I did one thing, even one change that I made a difference. And that was like, instead of brainstorming on the flip chart, which we used back then, you know, I would have people do brain writing, which, you know, we talk about in some of the books about, you know, you write down your ideas and you give the introverts a chance to go deeply, like Glenn was saying and Theo, and then share. And by the way, it benefited everybody in the class, even if there were a few extroverts in. So I studied it and I looked at how could we make the class more introvert friendly. And just the postscript to that was we had the meeting planner come to our room and tell us to pipe down. We were talking too much and we were laughing too much. And it speaks to also what Theo was saying about the connection when you can really identify people who are like you in terms of introversion. So I know I went off kind of like extroverts do. We think aloud. That's one of the things that happens. I think your original question was about strengths. So I think maybe I'll kick it over to Glenn or Theo to answer that, and then I can follow up. Does that sound good?
Sure. Yeah. Well, one thing I did want to bring up, it has to do with extroverted managers, right? And I think one thing we haven't actually mentioned just yet, right, in terms of defining introversion, is the fact that in Western cultures, introverts are typically going to be in the minority. So there's research has it, I think, anywhere from 16 to 50%. I kind of split it in the middle. Regardless, typically it's underrepresented, and it's probably even less represented in certain roles and in even industries. So I think that's why there has to be a degree of sensitivity around it, because if in Western cultures you have an extrovert ideal, and then you have a population that is, you know, in the minority and they're kind of outnumbered, that leads to a very a skewed version of what is normal. I really, really appreciate Theonette bringing up the whole concept of normal. You know, what is normal? Well, unfortunately, the majority typically defines what normal is, and no one's really going around consciously doing that. And this is where the danger comes in, that it's unconscious in terms of an affinity bias. And that, and again, I'm not an extrovert, right? So we have one here on the panel, Jennifer, so maybe you can key in on this, but I'd have to assume that you have some extroverts that are unconsciously looking for people like themselves, because that's what humans do. They recognize people that are similar to themselves. They like people that are similar to themselves. And when introverts come into the room, sometimes they just don't come across as very likable. They're not like them. They're hard to read. They're not really responding to the stimulation they're throwing out. And I think that it's important to recognize that and just have, especially extroverted managers, understand and appreciate and respect the fact that, you know, introverts bring just as much value, maybe in some different ways, than extroverts. And that goes, it ties into the strength element, that there's going to be complementary elements of extroverts and introverts. And that's where really, I think the power of diversity comes from, is in many ways, I think, rooted in cognitive diversity, which we might be able to talk about a little bit later during this session, just like how people approach situations, which, and my last point is, it may have nothing to do with your age or the color of your skin, or your gender or gender identity. It actually has more to do with how you look at the world and how you process information. I feel like that's where the real value comes in there. And it's important for extroverted managers to recognize that and not just assume that if somebody isn't speaking up enough, right, that they're not as valuable or they're not as engaged or they don't have as much to bring to the table. You have to be able to recognize that they may be operating in an environment where they don't feel very comfortable, that you may actually kind of be oppressing them to some extent. And that's a strong word, but in some environments, they may feel really minimized and not able to be their authentic selves. And that's where it's important for a leader to do that with everyone, regardless of their personality, but especially in this case, because personality is invisible. And that's where the intersectionality comes in. I think it cuts across, it's already been mentioned, but it's worth saying again, introversion, you can't just look at somebody and say, oh, they're an introvert extrovert. Maybe you can after observing them for a period of time, but even then it could be tricky because some introverts have to kind of cover and fake it. So they may actually be faking like they're an extrovert at work because they feel like they have to, which actually is psychologically draining, by the way, like twice as bad as it should be. These are all just things that I think extroverted managers need to think about so that they can allow the introverted employees to bring their best selves to work and employ their strengths, which is, you know, empathy, listening, deep thinking, reflective thought, big picture thinking also in some ways. They're not going to be thinking while they talk. They might have to go away for a while and come back with some brilliant ideas. But if you don't create an environment where they can do that, and if all the spotlight is on the meeting, and if they don't speak up in the meeting, you may be actually missing out on some of the best ideas of your employees because of your assumption of how people should think and present information.
Wow. Glenn, I don't know if Glenn, you realize this, but when you were talking about introvert strengths, you could have also just been reading from our list of Amazon leadership principles. We talk about dive deep. We talk about invent and simplify. We talk about being really data driven. And then sometimes we find ourselves in environments where we're not actually creating the space or the opportunity for people who excel at that to bring that to their work and bring that to their team. Dionette, I'd love to pivot to you with this question. You are an Amazonian leader, and you've already put a lot of thought and data-driven work into iConnect. And I'd love to hear, as an introverted leader here at Amazon, what are you excited seeing Amazon doing or opportunities you see for us to evolve in supporting the strengths of our introverted leaders? What are you excited to see in the coming year?
Thank you for the question, Lydia. I would say one of the amazing things about being part of Amazon is we are a really diverse company, and not just necessarily in terms of diversity traits, but we also leave a lot of freedom for people to be able to be themselves and to create. The fact that we have a group like iConnect with over 800 people involved right now has already speaks for itself. And I wanted to just go a little bit back and say, with iConnect overall, we promote personality and thought as part of diversity, inclusion, and belonging here at Amazon. And so by doing this, we want to focus a little bit on introversion because we do recognize that introverts, over the course of their lives, they get promoted a little bit less. They are paid less, and they struggle overall with visibility. So because we consider this, we want to work on destigmatizing what introversion is, redefining what it means, and overall creating a workspace where everyone with the right skills and attitude can thrive regardless of personality traits. And so by saying this, I wanted to also say to the introverts out there, if you are on a team, take your manager with you on this journey. And I'm actually so proud of my manager because we had a learning journey through iConnect. I did my research. I talked to her about it openly, and she has been displaying a lot of learn and be curious because she kept asking. So that ties also into ongoing conversation. She kept asking, how can I support? What can I do? And I kept explaining, this is how I work. This is what we can do differently. And I noticed that in a couple of calls recently, she started saying, for example, feel free to follow up with an email. And it could be a small thing, but I do recognize that my manager is already learning. Same with your coworkers. Keep explaining, keep the conversation going. And we don't want to place all of the responsibility on introverts and say, speak up. I have been told that, and it's counterintuitive. But I would say, own it. You cannot change that you're an introvert. And in fact, it is a superpower. You are who you are, and you bring with you a richness of experiences, of excellent skill set that are necessary at Amazon. So with the extroverts, so talk to your team, explain to them. And for the extroverts, listen and be a little bit more open that people are different from you, but they bring with them other skills that you might not have, as you also bring some things that they might not have. The other thing I would also say is consider with this work, working on personality, when you look at the nature of cognitive diversity itself, you come to a point where you realize that at the end of the day, it's not so much about whether you are introvert or extrovert. It really is about just leveraging as a manager and as a team the different skill set that people are bringing, and also leaving room for people to be different and be themselves and excel in the things that they are really good at. And what I'm looking forward to for Amazon is we just keep this conversation going. Once the stigma of what an introvert is and this assumption has gone away, I think we will get to a point where people will say, well, she's just an introvert. That would be really amazing. But also, we are creating trainings where we are focusing on, for example, how managers should give feedback to their introverted direct reports, or for those extroverts working with introverted managers, also for them to be able to have these ongoing conversations about how feedback can be given back in a way that resonates with them and that makes sense to them. The other thing is we are also creating trainings for hiring managers so that already at the entry level of Amazon, during the hiring process, people are aware of things like affinity bias and enthusiasm bias, because it's not really about how excited someone is about the job. It's about whether they can do the job and whether they can do it well. So that's something to think about. And what I'm also loving is we are in the process of applying for affinity group status. And what excites me about this is, although we already have a very diverse community, we will be able to reach more people. And I do know that for me, the important thing in my journey with iConnect was when Katarina, the sponsor of iConnect, in a room full of people, self-identified as an introvert, I had an immediate mental shift because I grew up thinking that to be a leader, you had to be a certain way. And now I see introverted leaders, they are not the most talkative people, but they are leaders and they are just a little bit different, but that is okay. And it has changed the way that I view myself, and it has changed the way that I show up on teams and interact with other people. I'm also looking forward to a point where we can say, create quiet working spaces, for example, for those people who are a little bit more introverted, so that they would have the opportunity to, just like we have actually conference rooms for people to gather, to brainstorm, to be with each other, lunch rooms. Similar to that, if we at Amazon or in all of the companies, we have spaces where introverts can go in and work in quiet and focus deeply. And because we have already been building on this by destigmatizing, people would then understand that someone working alone is not about them being weird. It's just they need a little bit of space. They are a little bit different, and that is totally okay. That's from my side. And
Fiona, I think you just perfectly segued into the next question that I'm excited to ask is, you know, there's so many ways, small and large, that companies can build more inclusive environments that really enable everyone to meet their full potential. And then 2020 kind of threw a wrench in a lot of those in-person solutions. So I'd love our panelists to think back to the before times in office spaces, but then also to share what they've seen recently with, you know, often a great shift to primarily working from home. What are some of the things that businesses and leaders can do to really create and bolster that introvert-friendly work environment? Both in the office, if you have one, and digitally in the age of COVID-19. Glenn, if you're all right with it, I'll start with you.
Sure. Yeah, so I would say, I have to share a super short personal story early in my work career around, being off by myself and being worried about being judged and being a little vulnerable. So one of my first jobs outside of college, I really enjoyed working with the three people I worked with in a lab. So I worked in a room in a laboratory environment with these three people day in, day out. When it came time for lunch, you couldn't eat in the lab, right? So you had to go to the lunch room. And that was like a horrific idea to me. I never ate in there once. I worked there for over 2 years. I ate lunch in my car every day. And I know I shared this with the Annette before. And I know even looking back, when I say it, I'm even self-conscious about it. It probably sounds kind of sad. I would read and I would eat my lunch in my car, and this was in Maryland, and it would get cold and I would still be out there doing it because, number one, I preferred the alone time. I didn't want the awkward situation of having to talk to people I don't know and have conversations I don't really care about, which I know it sounds horrible. Hopefully some people listening are saying, okay, it's okay that you're not alone, that you might feel the same way. You do need some time to get away. And like, what if I don't want forced social interaction? You know, you should give people those options. So that kind of segues into the rest of my answer, but just wanted to share a little bit of, I've been that guy that people probably watched as they were going out to find some place to eat, and they're looking at this dude in his car every day. Probably thought I was antisocial. I wasn't at all. I just needed a little time. I needed a break. I didn't want the forced social interaction. So that's one thing. Keep that in mind with regard to whether we're back at work in person or even working from home. I feel like there's been a significant trend. I don't know if anyone else has felt this in Amazon, but in my company, it seems like working from home, there's been somewhat of an overcompensation to say, maybe we need to actually have more meetings because we're not seeing each other in the office every day. And sometimes, you know, you're thinking, hey, working from home as an introvert is a dream, right? But what happens if you start doubling your meetings because it's an overcompensation for the lack of physically being together? So be aware of that, because Zoom or Chime or Google Meet fatigue is very real, and having to be on all the time in meetings back to back all day long is incredibly draining, whether it's in person or it's in video. In fact, there's actually been some people saying that video calls can actually be more draining than in-person calls for a number of reasons. And I think that can disproportionately affect introverts, whereas extroverts might say, you know what, instead of sending me an email, I'm just going to have a video call. I'm like, well, maybe the introverts might want to actually write rather than be in a social type of setting in a call. I guess just a couple more things to mention there would be, it goes to the interviewing thing that Theonette talked about. You want to make sure that introverts get into your workplace in the first place, right? Introverts often won't be making a lot of eye contact during interviews. I know I'm the same way. I tend to look away when I think. Some people may take that as this guy's not that engaged. It might take me a while to actually think about how to respond to a question, which might make people think that I don't really know what I'm talking about, or I'm not a really good candidate, because it might take me a while to reflect that I'm not super fast and thinking off the, you know, on my feet or off the top of my head, when in fact, The speed at which somebody answers a question has nothing to do with what Theonet said, which is, will they do their job exceptionally well? And an interview is even an artificial construct of, does that even have any really real bearing on whether they'll do the job well or not? They might interview horribly and be a great employee. And I'm sure everyone that's listening has probably interviewed somebody who's interviewed well that wasn't that good of an employee. So it's not that good of a proxy. So it's something that you have to be aware of. And I'll just close up by saying, I think you just have to simply, everyone has to simply recognize, understand, and appreciate and respect the diversity of personality. The differences between introverts and extroverts, they bring different strengths and challenges to the table, and it's the combination of the two that makes magic in many cases. And just make sure that we start to erode that unconscious extrovert ideal. I think that would be a good step in the right direction.
So much to respond to here. Lydia, can I jump in? Great, okay. I know we've kind of moved into a lot of directions. I wanted just to push back a little bit on something that was said earlier. And we get this a lot from people when we're talking about introversion and extroversion. Don't label, don't stereotype. I'm not suggesting anybody on this panel has. But I will say there, one of the things to consider is there's a lot of extroverted leaders who are making good efforts to understand introversion and are actually better in some cases that introverted leaders are, because the introverted leaders haven't really been intentional necessarily about doing that. For instance, people who are promoted because of their technical competence may not have had the sort of leadership training and understanding about communication skills and flexible styles. So I think we just have to be careful about in any way stereotyping. I'm not saying the panel is, but all of us need to look at that, you know, as something. I will say to that point, I was working with a company, this has happened several times, where the introverted leader called me in and didn't want to use introvert in the title of the program. They thought it was too, you know, they didn't want to be out there with that. There were lots of examples of that. And I think still, because we haven't gotten to the point where introversion in the culture is accepted, we are, it takes a long time to get there. I love the quote by Edgar Schein, the organizational psychologist, who said, it's what leaders do and what they pay attention to that will ultimately change the culture. And I think in a way, that's really what we're talking about here, is being very intentional about recognizing introverts, but also extroverts. So that the work that we did in the book, I wrote a book called Genius Opposites a few years ago. And what we found is that we looked at numerous teams of self-identified introverts and extroverts together. And what we found is they performed at high levels when they could follow some good principles around communicating and getting the best out of each other, which we have a 5-step model in there. But it was really interesting to look at that exponentially they were better than necessarily, you know, the teams of just introverts or just extroverts. So it speaks to what we're just saying here. Diversity is absolutely key. But I think we're at the point now where we need to highlight introverts because they haven't been highlighted. And it's the same. I've done a lot of work in gender with women, and you know, people will say, well, why are you having a group just for women? Well, we need to really get empowered ourselves first, right? Before we go out and try to engage with other people. So that was just something that struck me about what was said. And the last thing I just want to throw in here is we've kind of talked around it, but haven't directly said, a couple of things have come up about strengths. And I really, what I have found is a consistent theme. And when we've been doing these, we do interviews and then we write up, you know, models on this, is that introverts seem to do their best when they don't stop trying to become extroverts, and they can tap into that well of incredible strengths that you've heard so many examples of here today, you know, that Glenn and Theo and you were sharing. And the strengths that I, you know, have come up time and time again, and I'd love to hear what the other panelists think about this. Listening, you know, observation, the writing has been talked about, like, you know, getting a well thought out, well crafted email from somebody instead of just a line where they kind of just got it out of their inbox, you know, where they gave it some thought. One-on-one focused conversations. In the work that we did on influence, we found that introverts not only engaged in listening very deeply, but they took it the next step. And those who were successful and effective in getting their projects accepted, from making changes in the organization, from inspiring other people on their teams, a lot of that had to do with the one-on-ones that, you know, Glenn was talking about, and Theo is engaging with people and understanding what their resistance is and like talking through that with them instead of doing that in a large, you know, Zoom meeting. So it's not necessarily answering the question you said. I have some thoughts on that too, but I just wanted to make sure that we know that introverts rock, and you guys need to, in terms of making differences, it's about really tapping into that well of strength. So I would like to ask Theo and Glenn, do you have any other strengths that you would say are really, you use the term superpowers, Theo, about, you know, what introverts do really well that you would like to highlight?
I would just say another superpower also for introverts is people skills, actually. Mm-hmm. And for me, it manifests itself in a way that I am able to bring people together. It's something I have always excelled at, and I'm able to see it play out now with iConnect, and it's really fantastic how this community has grown and the whole movement, how it just took off. I wanted to go back a little bit though and talk about COVID-19 and the strengths of introverts tie all of that together. So I wanted to say, for us at Amazon, this year has been actually very interesting. In March, we started working from home, and we have outdone ourselves just how we transitioned smoothly into it, and how we manage it overall. And because I'm in recruitment, I was able to see all of the impact and the difference we were making in the lives of the people, actually, because with COVID, many people were being laid off, and we were the people behind the scenes, scheduling those panels, making sure that these people were able to get jobs, making sure that they were, because we had to overnight also change to virtual rather than on-site interviews. And we have navigated that so perfectly. Speaking of that, another good thing that also came out of COVID-19 and working from home is for the introverts. And I cannot speak for everyone, but I know for myself that it has been amazing, because I am able to, the whole day I'm at home, so I get a lot of time to think, to process, to have that downtime. And I book calls when I have gained all of that energy. So it's not like someone can walk into you in the office and you have to kind of get caught up in a conversation that you don't know how to get out of. And I'm not saying we don't love conversations, we do enjoy it as well, but I'm just talking about the positive things of what COVID-19 has brought. And in my case, because Dr. Romney actually in her last session did a distinction on the different types of introverts. And in my case, I'm an introvert who is also anxious and very shy. I was bullied throughout my school life. I also, at home, we are more extroverted. So I have a lot of trauma from that, and I have a lot of I've also internalized certain things about the extrovert ideal. So working from home has kind of given me that space to use some of those superpowers and start up this community. And it's a bunch of emails that I have written. I wrote Glenn an email, and I didn't even think he would read it, and he did read it, and he wrote me a long email back as well. Same with Jennifer. I have also sourced Lydia. So I have brought together all of these people, and that's one of our introverted strengths. Another thing I also wanted to just bring into this is the intersectionality element. And I think understanding personality as a whole, understanding introversion, extroversion, is also going to, as a company, as a society, kind of change the way we view people. Because if you look at that intersectionality element, someone could be already having other diversity traits that could potentially influence the way that they navigate the work environment. It's just so severe. People can stay in the same position over and over again and struggle with visibility. And another thing that I would also say about Amazon is the leaders here are so open. I was able to recently have the director of recruiting ops, Jenna Power, speak, and I had just pinged her casually, and she responded. Same with Katarina. as someone who kind of helped me come up with, put all of this together, I reached out to her after she came to our office and mentioned she's an introvert, and she dealt with it so graciously and carefully and so beautifully. And I have seen myself grow in all of this. And I would say, I want to add mentorship to this. Mentorship is one of the most important things for introverts. Find yourself leaders that you admire and work with them closely. Make sure that because we spend from 9 to 5, you are at work. Ultimately, it's part of your life if you look at it that way. So I know that for many of us introverts, we struggle with small talk. Make your life intentional. Reach out to leaders that you know you will have a strong conversation with, the kind of conversation that some of us really need to thrive on. And another thing with mentorship is it can also teach you how to present yourself, how to communicate in a way that your thoughts can make sense to other people. So if you're an introvert right now, I hope you are able to find iConnect so that we can set you up with a mentor and you can enjoy your journey here. And at an early age, you might be able to have a better experience in the work environment.
That's an introverted leader right there, right, Lydia?
Right there. I love
it. That is the definition of an introverted leader. I'll do a shameless plug, but that's it. Right there.
Perfection. We've got just time for a couple more questions. And I'm so excited to hear. I think you're already all thinking about how the strange year that was 2020 has provided the opportunity for a lot of growth and a lot of positive momentum. Right now, Amazonians across the world are thinking about the strange year that was 2020. And we're in a season of filling out our fortes and identifying our own strengths and opportunities for growth. And then also identifying their colleagues or their direct reports. But this is really kind of a driving piece of our personal and professional development here at Amazon as leaders. But we're coming out of a year that has felt really strange. And a lot of people have felt, I think, kind of stalled out in their personal and professional growth because they've been often pulled into a totally different environment or a different work cadence than maybe they had first signed up for or worked so hard to acclimate to. So I'm going to ask, in this year where people are looking back on a strange 2020 and looking ahead to growth opportunities, especially for our introverted leaders, what career development advice do you have for them as they plan ahead for the year to come? Athena, I think you shared most recently a lot of the resources that iConnect is offering. So I'll start with you, any additional advice, and then I'll move to Glenn and then Jennifer for advice they have for introverted leaders working to advance their careers.
Thank you for the question, Lydia. I had already touched on this a little bit before with mentorship, and that's something that I really live by because just building these relationships at work, it kind of adds to that kind of intentional and purposeful living that many introverts are sort of geared towards. So I would just say, go out there, get mentorship, reach out to people. You don't necessarily have to do it extrovert style. Take your time, write your long email, let it sit for 3 days in your draft box. I did that a lot. I would have it sit for a week, for example, and finally I would have the courage to send it out. But do it. The worst that can happen is they will say no to you. Then you have the answer and you can keep it moving. I will just pass it on to Jennifer and Glenn now. Thank you.
Glenn, you want to go?
Sure. So just a couple of quick thoughts. Athenet did touch upon one thing. I just want to mention it again. You know, as you navigate your career, finding people who will be an advocate for you, not just a manager or a leader, but an advocate, and for you as an in, as a whole person, which includes your introversion. So if we're talking about introverted leaders and introverts trying to advance their career, there's probably nothing more powerful than that, because you can do everything else, but if you don't have someone who's advocating for you, your probability of advancement is relatively lower, I would say. I do think that whoever you're currently reporting to, you know, even if you're not comfortable, and I've been there myself in terms of kind of outing myself as an introvert and kind of explaining when somebody provides me feedback that I'm not speaking up enough, things along those lines, that's very common. Bring up the topic of introversion and explain that. If you don't get it on the table, it can't be recognized, you can't do anything about it. And hopefully you're working with a leader who will say, okay, I see you for who you are. Okay, now I understand a little bit more about you, something I was unconsciously responding to. Now let's now consciously address it. I think that's important. Another thing that has helped me in my career, because I know I have a relatively high title, so people are like, hey, you know, you haven't hit some kind of a ceiling. I would say there's a whole lot more to that story that people don't know, but I would say throughout my career, what's really helped me as an introvert is becoming an expert at least one or a few things, becoming known for something, because then it's not so much unconsciously about how well liked you are. And I know everyone thinks that during reviews and things like that, that it's totally neutral, but just remember, we're humans. It's called unconscious bias for a reason. It's unconscious. Even trying to think about it is kind of a conundrum. In fact, some studies have actually shown that being consciously aware of something actually made something worse. So my honest advice is try to find one or more areas that you can excel in, that you can be known for, so that people are drawn to you. And I found that's helped me a lot. Advancement in my career has come from expertise. And even if people didn't perceive me to be the most likable or outgoing individual, and I didn't play the game very well, and I still don't, you can't deny the expertise in certain areas, and that can help you advance in that area because you're bringing value. And then last thing I'll say is make sure you help people out in return. As an introverted leader, if you get into a position of leadership, you have an extreme amount of responsibility to make sure that you are incredibly fair and equitable with all the people you work with, but make sure that you turn back around and see how you can become an advocate for other introverts and make sure that there isn't that systemic cycle of extroverts mm-hmm. tending to be, you know, promoted more frequently than introverts.
I love that. It's a love fest. There's so much meat there. Yeah, thank you. I think in terms of the two sides of it, one is developing yourself and, as I said, building on your strengths. So there's a model I like to refer to, or framework, that seems to help folks, and it's called the four P's. Very practical. And it's, first of all, building on the strength of preparation. So in any area that you're going towards, whether you want to get better in public speaking or you want to network, whatever it is, you prepare, and that's what you do well. So that's a very important piece to think about as you're developing your leadership skills and your career development. The second part is presence. The second P is presence. So you get out of your head. We all need to do this, and just be there. Be where our feet are. Be with the person. Be with the audience. Be with the whatever situation you're in. We know that we can have that monkey mind in our head that can take us off the game. But the best introverted leaders are the ones who are there where their feet are. The third P is pushing. Push not so much that it's going to kill you, you know, you're going to strain a muscle, but that it's going to be a little uncomfortable. I think for all of the leaders that I've spoken with or coached, they are constantly challenging themselves, just like you heard some beautiful examples from Glenn and Theo today. So that's how we grow, and that's how we gain confidence. That's really critical, to gain confidence. And then the fourth P is the practicing. And like, you think about becoming a virtuoso and being a very strong, effective contributor. We're constantly refining those skills. I always like to look at the comedians. I enjoy going to comedy shows, and I see like people like Jerry Seinfeld constantly working on his craft. You could think of so many other performers who are always raising the bar. And that's what we want to do. We want to keep challenging ourselves, keep it fresh, and keep getting more effective. And so I think those would probably be the four key themes I would leave you with in terms of being very practical. Of course, we have it all outlined in the Introverted Leader, and on my website, there's a lot of free stuff. So thank you for asking, Lydia.
I love that. I'm so glad this is recorded because I want to go back through and take all the notes. And so as we move kind of toward the last few minutes of our time together, I'm going to move us to some parting words. So I'm going to start with Glenn and then Jennifer and then Theonette. And in our little speed round, I'm going to ask what are, you know, maybe your top one or two takeaways for introverts or their managers working to better include them and build an introvert-friendly workplace. And then I'd love to hear one resource you've created or you highly recommend that can help people on their journey of better understanding this topic. And then I'd love you to share how our audience can follow you, connect with you, or find the work you've done. So once again, that speed round is top takeaway, one resource or tool you highly recommend or created, and how our audience can connect with you and find the work you're doing in this space. Glenn?
All right. So two things in terms of top takeaways. So to the introverts that are watching this, I do want to say there's nothing wrong with you. You may have felt stigmatized or devalued or lesser than. Hopefully you don't still feel that way, but I know many of you do. It's something I still struggle with, to be perfectly honest. If someone were to give me a pill, they would say, hey, this would switch you from an introvert to an extrovert, I'd actually probably take it. And I'm only sharing that to show you that it's easy for me to say, hey, there's nothing wrong with you and you need to love yourself and appreciate yourself for who you are. But the reality is the world has not really made that easy for introverts. So it's something that is something you can focus on a daily basis. No, there's nothing wrong with you. You don't have to be fixed. You don't need to, you know, read books or take courses to figure out how to become more extroverted. You need to be able to find the power and the strength in you. And just keep in mind that this is heavily hereditary. So it's not like your efforts are going to be in vain anyway, right? So just keep that in mind. Appreciate yourself for who you are and start working on that journey of feeling comfortable with who you are. And you may never end that journey, but at least take the first step and try to head in that direction. The second point is meetings. Meetings are still not fun for me in some cases. They need to be moderated. There needs to always be a moderator in your meetings. It's not about how much people talk. It's about the quality of the interaction. Extroverts, you know, I don't like to use stereotypes, but I mean, we've all been in thousands of meetings. There's some people that just start talking and they think while they're talking and they end up dominating meetings. Introverts like me end up sitting there waiting to try to bring some insight that I have. Don't want to interrupt because it still feels rude. And I also feel like I shouldn't have to interrupt. You shouldn't change the nature of people's interaction just to make people speak up and talk over people. Just make sure meetings are moderated. Everyone has a chance to speak. I recommend that you send, this is multiples, I apologize, I'll be real quick. Send pre-reads ahead of time so they can prepare, so they can bring their best thoughts to the meeting, not having to think off the top of their head during the meeting, and also collect information and thoughts after the meeting. Because sometimes my best thoughts actually come after reflection. And if I don't say it in the meeting, people think, hey, Glenn had no value to add. It might come an hour later, it might come the next day. Super quick for me next is, you know, I don't have a lot of resources out there. The one thing I would recommend that I think you should watch, it tells a little bit more about my story, as well as some practical suggestions that companies can do to make their environments more inclusive of introverts. It's on YouTube. If you just Google introversion within diversity, inclusion, belonging, you can also Google my name and LinkedIn, and you'll certainly find the video. And then the article that's been mentioned a couple of times, it's something that, again, was 3 years in the making, and it covers a ton of research with tons of links to that. That would be that LinkedIn manifesto. So just search there. And that's the best way to find me and interact with me is LinkedIn as well.
Hey, everybody. I would say, Lydia, to answer your question, I think we all need to harness introvert talent, and it's the responsibility of each and every one of us to bring this to the awareness of our managers, our teams, our individually. We have work to do ourselves, as was discussed. So I think we all need to be a voice for the quiet, to be intentional in all of our practices. We mentioned hiring, we've talked about meetings briefly. There are 7 different areas that I focus on, or we focus on recently, in taking a look at an organization and how we deliver training. All of these aspects offer opportunities for us to flex to address the introvert temperament. So I encourage people to just keep your awareness open, and and make a case. It's the extroverts are running around and aren't feeling necessarily the pain. So I think all of us need to make, whether it's the business case or the fact that we're losing, I would say between 40 and 60% of our talent and our contributions. And that's just not a nice to have. That can really affect our productivity. So those would be just, you know, obviously you asked for one and we're all going on because there's so much to do. And I don't think you're going to cut off our mic, right? I hope not. Okay. So the second point is, where can people go? Well, there is this company that started out selling books. I know you all sell a lot more now, but all of my books are available on Amazon with some nice excerpts if you want to kind of check it out in the different forums, The Introverted Leader and et cetera. So also go to my website and check out, we have free quizzes there that go with each book and you can determine what's going well for you and where there might be opportunity for both you as an individual contributor, but also as a leader. So I would say those would be the you said it kind of parting words. I got a little sad there. Not our parting words forever, right? Okay, I think I covered it all. Thanks, Lydia. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Jennifer. Before I talk a little bit about iConnect, Theo, I'd love your parting words.
Oh, I just wanted to say to Jennifer, we would love to have you back here at Amazon. I wanted to say that now in COVID-19 times, we have learned that we can work from home, that some people function better in this environment. And I would say when we get out of this and we go back to our normal lives, I would say give people the option for those who work better at home, who are more productive, allow them to work from home and let those who work better from the office do that as well. I would also say collectively, we need to change the way that we look at leaders. There's not really one type of leader. And we also need to do away with the one size fits all kind of approach. Different things work for different people. And also when you are thinking of the strengths of extroverts, think of the strengths of introverts as well, and vice versa, because both of them are bringing on the table different set of skills that are just amazing in themselves. I would also like to say this quote from Katerina. She wrote this in the newsletter last year where she said, skills and capabilities come in all forms. A quiet person is as valuable as the most outspoken one. And as leaders, we need to be open to ideas in all forms and shapes. Diversity and inclusion are about creating a workspace where everyone with the right skills and attitude can thrive, irrespective of personality traits and other variables. Through respect and active listening, consciously asking for the opinions of everyone around the table, that is inclusion. Please go ahead.
I just, wow.
Some of the resources that I wanted to say is I would definitely recommend that you get yourself a copy of The Introvert Advantage by Dr. Marty Olsen-Laney. It's one of the best books on these topics. You could also educate yourself on cognitive functions because I think that's where the gold is. Knowing, for example, how your brain works, how to leverage your superpowers, knowing where your weaknesses are and consciously working on those. And lastly, yeah, you can find me on iConnect. I'm not perfect. On social media. Yeah.
No social media, no.
What a beautiful...
We'll work on you a little bit.
What a beautiful note to end with. I think to everyone's point, not parting words, just maybe a launch point for each of us in our continued journey. If you'd like to continue learning about the superpowers of introverts or topics we've discussed today, I do encourage Amazonians to join us here at iConnect. In addition to sessions like this, we run a mentorship program with introverted leaders and internal leaders helping to support them in their growth. We will continue to host educational resources like this and give you access and the opportunity to learn from our senior introverted leaders here at Amazon as well. We're excited to be working with our learning and development team to help create and expand trainings for people managers. And we are so excited in 2021 to provide thoughtful, focused conversations and networking and growth opportunities. So on behalf of our wonderful panel today and the team here at iConnect, I want to thank you for your time. Thank you for your interest. Have a great rest of your day. Take care, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.